analysis systémique,
systemic analysis or system dynamics play an essential role in the scientific method and a way to approach phenomena for scientists. For a very long time, people used to simplify the way they approached effects and facts and left aside everything that went beyond simplicity. Microeconomics, for instance, talks about economic agents trying to understand consumption or behaviors. Macroeconomics takes things as a whole, groups of companies, social groups, aggregates, and between the two, how do we talk about complexity? How do we refer to complexity? How do we admit that in a prospective scenario there may be a certainty, irreversibility, and that chance or random phenomena can cause a problem? And there is a threefold reply here as a method to solve problems. Complexity is admitted as a tool, an interesting tool that must be used, and the question is raised. What about behaviors? How do we change the way agents behave in a system? And how do we think about public policies, social policies, or possibly even policies regarding life on Earth? We may have to take decisions regarding irreversibility. The systemic analysis did not happen overnight. There were founding fathers who played an essential role. Wieder Norber, on the left-hand side of the slide, played a vital role in the way systemic analysis can be approached scientifically. He talked about cybernetics. He was a mathematician working on NASA systems and armament systems, and he wanted to know how to communicate, how to make systems communicate, and how to anticipate behaviors. Obviously, we're thinking about the behavior of a fighter pilot or a satellite, and Wieder thought about how to complexify programs, NASA programs. The second man who played an essential role, Bertolt Brecht, who thought that the system is always happen, flows come in, flows go out, and because the system is open, it becomes self-organized. It starts functioning by itself, it evolves, and self-organization plays an essential role. The third man is Jay Forrester, who comes from MIT, who is the man who worked on the Meadows report, the simulation model of the disaster effect of natural resources becoming exhausted. And the fourth man did not talk about systemics, but he had the capacity to go over, look at the whole systemic field. Edgar Morin, who said that cybernetic systemic analysis was a capacity to navigate within uncertainties, serendipity, and complexity. Now, systemic analysis is something based on a strong architecture, a structural architecture, but there are several questions here. A system has borders. It may be limited, it may be open, a company may be totally closed on its capital equity, but open towards the shareholders, for instance. A system also shows the elements which agents define the system. When we talk about an ecosystem, we may imagine that fauna or flora are among the various elements. But the elements also interact with each other. Information flows and communication plays an essential role. I did not mention it so far, but Shannon and Viver's work played a role because these economists were also scientists, thought about communication. There is an element emitting communication, one receiving it, and there are biases, cognitive biases. And when you receive a message, you have to be sure that there was no bias and that you really got the message. Fourth element, an ecosystem will also raise questions of how to store the information, how to encrypt it, and understand the information and why storing the information will be useful to for the evolution of the system. Therefore, the systemic approach went beyond the structural approach and allowed something that is being criticized today by in terms of functioning. When we talk about functioning, operating, we talk about flows. For a very long time, we stored elements and we played under storage capacity. But material and energy flows today play an essential role in the system. systemic approach. Behind the flows, there are people who take decisions, and decision-making centers play a role because they forward the information on the flows, for instance, and they also have to decode, understand, and possibly modify the information. There might be a cognitive bias or bluff that will play an essential role in systemic understanding. A system has loops. Some loops are positive retroactive loops. They amplify the phenomenon. Sometimes the loops are negative. They stabilize the phenomenon. All models, all systemic cycles have loops, positive or negative loops. Fourth functional element, the time for response. Not all systems have the same time. Nature takes longer to react. Economic growth acts on the short term, and short termism might be in opposition with long termism. Something that played an essential role in the Meadows report, the population loop. If you remember what I said about systemic approaches, you remember I said there was a positive and a negative loop. The positive loop will amplify the phenomenon. What does it mean exactly? If the food quota were to increase in a developing country, if the birth rate were to increase, demography would increase. Therefore, the wealth per capita would decrease. This is an exponential loop that destabilizes the system. On the opposite, a high death rate and a decrease in the food quota per capita will reduce the population. I'm forgetting about ethics. Voluntarily. A systemic approach will allow you to understand the complexity of phenomena, and everybody will understand the conditions, and everybody will be able to take the opportunity behind the analysis of an economic factor. Thank you.